We've pulled together a very impressive assembly of speakers on a very important topic here today, and we're very grateful to them for joining us. Dr. Anthony Fauci, Director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, Moncef Slaoui from GlaxoSmithKline, Chairman of GSK Vaccines, Johan von Hoof, Global Therapeutic Area Head, Infectious Diseases and Vaccines at Janssen Research and Development of the Johnson & Johnson Pharmaceutical Companies, and Julie Gerberding, President of Merck Vaccines, former Director of CDC, and Rohit Malpani, Director of Policy and Analysis at the MSF, the Medecins Sans Frontières Access Campaign. So please join me in welcoming all of them for coming here, many of them a long distance to be here with us. We are at a pivotal moment in the unfolding Ebola crisis as 2004 comes to a conclusion. This is a pivotal moment to talk about the efforts that have been underway on an accelerated basis to bring forward the development of Ebola vaccines and therapeutics, and to discuss today what lies ahead in 2015. We won't be dealing today too much with diagnostics, and I hope we can come back and revisit that critical issue in the new year. In the midst of this urgent, fluid, and dangerous Ebola emergency, exceptional things have begun to happen. At a point early in the fall, I would argue, perceptions changed fundamentally, and diverse experts working on Ebola began to argue, they began to realize that new technologies, vaccines, diagnostics, and therapy, some of which were in development or had been in development for some time, that these would be strategically essential to bringing about a conclusive control to arresting the runaway Ebola epidemic. That implied that there would have to be an extraordinary effort undertaken on an expedited basis, and that they would be added to the front line of essential public health interventions which we've heard about and which we'll continue to hear about today, of efforts to isolate, contain, ensure safe burials, carry out contact tracing, supply protective equipment, introduce effective public communications and engagement of communities to build trust and confidence. This triggered in this fall an accelerated mobilization across many different institutions and a high sense of urgency. And that includes the leadership of Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea, leadership, scientists, ministerial officials, community leaders, regulatory bodies. It included multiple US agencies dedicated to research and development, to delivery of programs, NIH, CDC, the Department of Defense, USAID, regulators at FDA, multiple key industrial players, of whom GSK, Johnson & Johnson, and Merck represented here today. Foundations became very important players, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Paul Allen, Mark Zuckerberg, Hewlett Foundation. International organizations clearly playing a vital role, WHO, the Gavi, the Vaccines Alliance. Just this past Thursday, the board of Gavi committed to up to $300 million for purchase of a vaccine once approved by WHO, along with $90 million in rollout support and strengthening of immunization programs. The World Bank, African Development Bank, have joined this effort. On the NGO side, MSF, which has been the standout true heroes of the response over the course of 2014 in this saga, not surprisingly, have jumped forward to assist with trials of antivirals, convalescent plasma, and we'll hear of possibly of vaccines later in 2015. This mobilization has been remarkable in several ways. It's an unusual speed and the flexibility and cooperation, which we'll hear more about, that's been seen across these different institutions. There was a pivotal meeting October 23rd hosted by WHO, which established a club of donors. Industry revised upwards projected manufacturing capacities. A certain pragmatism and debate opening, which we'll hear more about whether it's possible to adhere to classic randomized control trials versus less rigorous, but still very important efforts. A lot of demonstrated regulatory flexibility, a lot of effort to begin to prepare communities. This was driven by a number of factors. I think the urgency of the threat, the high risks of inaction, the potential for significant returns that people felt, there was a certain optimism and determination that entered this equation, and a commitment to operate in good faith for a common cause. Also, what was interesting and unusual was the degree to which these different institutions began to think in longer term, to plan and prepare beyond the emergency, and to think ahead into even the second generation of technologies and what were going to be required. There obviously was a shared recognition of the security threat, the humanitarian imperative, and the need for U.S. leadership, both private and public, in partnership with other critical institutions. Money, interestingly, does appear to be less of an obstacle than might otherwise have been the case or what might have been predicted. That's an unusual and, I think, very favorable position to be in at this point. It doesn't mean that sustainable funding is not still an outstanding question. $5.4 billion emergency funding in the omnibus bill passed by Congress just a short while ago, terribly important in bringing forward several hundred million dollars in additional resources in accelerating and developing and delivering technologies. I mentioned Gavi, the EU, the UK, and others. These developments notwithstanding, the flip side is there remain considerable levels of uncertainty and obstacles, which we'll talk about here today. First and foremost is the epidemic itself and the continued uncertainty around its trajectory. But as pertains to the new technologies, there's a few things that are continuing to be at the center of the debate. One is around the science, and we'll hear more about the efforts to demonstrate safety, efficacy, dosage, to work on thermal stability, and related to that is the ethical challenges in terms of what types of field trials will be possible. And what sort of access will be possible in this period. There's a lot of discussion around delivery, around manufacturing, stockpiles, cold chains, indemnification. There's a lot around coordination. There's so many moving parts that we see here today, and the question of how to coordinate those. Who's going to be at the center of this effort? WHO ostensibly should carry this responsibility and has risen in certain key moments to carry the water, but operates with diminished capacities and a damaged reputation. There is a question around how to bring it back, build it back in a more effective way to be relevant and continue to be very relevant. Thinking ahead strategically, we'll hear more about that today. We need to be thinking about a second generation, about greater quality in the thermal stability and fewer doses and sustained funding in this period. So we want to take care today to take stock of what has happened in these last few very busy months and to look ahead optimistically and very realistically to what may unfold in 2015. I'm convinced 2015 has considerable promise to be a watershed, not without continued high uncertainty, trials, and difficulties. So we're going to begin with a sequence of opening remarks, starting with Dr. Fauci, followed by Moncef Slaoui of GSK, followed by Johan von Hoof from Janssen, Johnson & Johnson, Julie Gerberding from Merck, and Rohit Malpani in MSF. So please, you have their bios. I've introduced them very briefly. I'm not going to go into great depth. Please be patient. We're going to roll through these presentations. Then thereafter, we'll have about an hour for conversation, perhaps more. We'll close at 5. We'll have a conversation among the group, and then we'll open to you to hear from you. And please come forward. There will be folks with microphones. We'll bundle together 3 or 4 comments and questions at a time and come back to our speakers. Please identify yourself and keep your interventions very succinct. So with that, I'd like to ask Tony to come forward and roll through his presentation. Thank you so much.
So Could we get the, is it just the next one? Next slide. Slides? Hello? Steve? Okay. We sent the slides, so. Tell you what. What we've been through over the last few months, a bunch of botched slides don't mean anything. Okay. Okay, so do you at least have them? That's what I get for doing the TV
Tony,
interview
before. Tony, we received them and loaded them. So there's been some glitch. We'll work that through momentarily. If you want to offer some opening remarks.
Yeah, well, why don't I just start without them, and then we could just to go to show you that I don't really need the slides. So I'm going to take 10 or 12 minutes, and I'm going to outline for you some of the, this, just to set the stage. First of all, the seriousness of this epidemic, this outbreak now, as you all know, the history of it started with a single case in Guinea, was under the radar screen literally for a few months until March, when in earnest, the three borders of Sierra Leone, Guinea, and Liberia made for what I have spoken about and written about as the perfect storm of so many reasons why, in fact, we have an explosive epidemic that is more out of control than anything in the history of this particular microbe, this virus, when it was first discovered in 1976. And again, people don't, maybe not everyone appreciates that since 1976, we've had about 24 outbreaks for a total of about 2,400 people infected and 1,200 people dead. So if you look at the 18,000 infections and 7,000 to 8,000 deaths now, which is likely somewhat of a modest undercount, this pandemic in this area, or epidemic when one thinks of the Africa in general, has really been extraordinary in that it's more than anything that we have seen combined over that period of time. Now, the efforts that have contained these other outbreaks in the past have been a variety of things that are essentially fundamental good infrastructure, good response, good ability to identify, isolate, contact trace, and protect healthcare workers. This was not easy, but it was relatively easy when one thinks in terms of the fact that you have very few situations of traveling back and forth. If you look at the original outbreaks that took place in Zaire and in Sudan, the Kikwit outbreak in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, they were all ultimately controlled. So now we have something that we are making progress, because if one looks at Liberia with the insertion of resources from a variety of governments, the United States has been very heavily involved in Liberia, the UK, in Sierra Leone, but there have been a variety of agencies involved that have put resources in, things like safe burials, et cetera. I know there is, but that didn't happen, okay. Here we go, okay, so this is where it started. So can I start now, Steve?
Sure, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so it started here, and then these things happened in May, and that's when people were starting to get a little bit concerned. In July, things really got bad, and then in September and October, at least my life changed and turned into an intern in medicine again, which translates into getting no sleep when you're involved in a very intense situation. Then November and then December, and here's what we're seeing actually right now with the Sierra Leone cases essentially overtaking considerably the cases in Liberia. Now, I mentioned the public health responses that were actually involved in keeping these things and the infected countries under control. Everything really, without looking at things like Ebola-specific therapeutics and certainly not a vaccine. Education, hygienic practices, contact tracing, safe burials, aggressive supported care. I mentioned the United States getting involved with the construction of Ebola treatment units, the Department of Defense playing a major role when the president called in the Department of Defense and brought in the ability to do the engineering, command and control, and the setup of Ebola treatment units became a very, very important. The CDC did an unprecedented job together with USAID in the number of people that they have now deployed to this area. So it's been an extraordinary effort. However, we're asking the question now, and this is what I want to focus my few minutes on, in that will we need interventions in the form of vaccines and therapeutics for the current outbreak, which is entirely possible, because until you completely snuff out every case in West Africa, as we know about Ebola, until all the embers are out, there's always a threat of an outbreak. And we've seen that, and we know it can happen. So that's very important. So the two things about vaccine that I want to throw out for discussion is that do we need a vaccine to put down this epidemic? And even if we don't get one in time, or we don't prove that it's effective, will we need it? And I say yes, for the inevitable outbreaks that are occurring. Now, why am I telling the audience this? Is because it's going to be very important to know whether the vaccine works. Because the thing you don't want to do is to deploy a vaccine that might be harmful or that you may assume works, and then for the next epidemic, you have a problem. And that's going to be the tension that I hope we get a chance to discuss about the design of a vaccine trial. So having said that, when one thinks of vaccines that are either already in, well in phase one, getting ready to go to phase two, three, there are two of them. Another booster now with the MVA getting involved would make it, I would say, 2.5 or 3. There's another 3 that you're going to hear about, not that they're any less in quality, because we don't really know about quality until you test. But temporally, they have not yet gone into phase one trial. And I want people to understand that, because I often get asked, is this the prioritization of vaccines? Yes and no, prioritization and getting it into an advanced trial, but not necessarily a predictive value of whether or not it is going to be better, which is why at a meeting we had at the NIH just the other day, Moncef himself argued strongly for many candidates to be in play at the same time. So let's focus very briefly on the two that are most advanced temporally, and that is the first, what we're calling the NIAID GSK vaccine, which is a chimp adeno-3 vector into which was inserted the gene of the glycoprotein. This has gone into phase one trials, but chimpanzee studies have indicated a very favorable protection using this particular candidate. That's good news. Also, phase one was relatively uneventful. We had individuals, 20 individuals at the NIH. We did it right there at the NIH. It was uneventful. It's been also tested in a monovalent form. We did a bivalent in the UK and will be set up to be also tested in Africa, in Mali and other African countries. This is the New England Journal of Medicine paper that came out in just literally a couple of weeks ago about the phase one trial. And we're now setting up for testing again an advanced trial using this. The other candidate is a VSV, same principle. The vector is a vesicular somatitis virus into which has been inserted the Ebola glycoprotein gene. Phase one trials fully enrolled. This again in collaboration with the Department of Defense. We're doing it at the NIH. Others are doing it from the Walter Reed Army Medical Institute by the Department of Defense, the United States Army. Again, now in collaboration also with Merck, and you'll be hearing more about that from Julie. The New Link company is the company that's involved. It originated in the Public Health Agency of Canada. As I mentioned, DOD together with NIAID and the phase one trials are enrolled. Merck is involved. Now, you may have heard that the trial was put on hold because of an arthritis. People get confused about that. There were four individuals that had what was clear inflammation. That doesn't mean it's the end of the vaccine by any means. Arthralgias, myalgias are very common. We saw it in a significant proportion of people when you give a live virus vaccine. In fact, you don't even have to give a live virus vaccine and you could see it in individuals. The question is, what is that going to mean? And that's why you have phase one trials, so you can investigate that pretty easily. The proposed forward paths are two, and again, this has been in very close collaboration with the Liberian health officials, is the plan of a randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled trial in Liberia and a stepped wedge trial in Sierra Leone with at least two in Liberia, the VSV and the chimp adeno, and possibly one or maybe two in Sierra Leone. We're working with the CDC now to decide about that. The pipeline of therapeutics, again, I want people to really appreciate that none of these have been shown to be effective. They've been given on compassionate use, and we do not know if any of them work. Mechanistically, you can figure out a way that they may work or not, but you're never going to know whether they work. And I also might make a comment that I think we'll get the chance to discuss. The distribution in a trial in which not everybody gets a particular intervention is different when you're dealing with a vaccine that you're giving to an absolutely healthy person compared to a therapeutic when you're giving it to someone who may be drastically ill. So when you think about the design of trials, that's the reason why the discussion of that is a bit different. Very quickly, ZMapp, you've heard about it. It's been given to several people on compassionate use. It's an antibody cocktail of three anti-glycoprotein antibodies that has been shown to protect monkeys. Small interfering RNA, the TKM Ebola, there are phase one trials that are ongoing. BCX4430, which is a nucleoside analog, which protect monkeys against Ebola, also in a phase one trial. Brincidofovir, which is a polymerase inhibitor developed for other viruses, but shown to have some activity against Ebola and has now been used with Marburg, but not yet with Ebola. And favipiravir, which is an RNA polymerase inhibitor, which has broad antiviral usage. It protects mice. It has not yet gone into a non-human primate. The reason I show you this, you can argue that these have potential, but remember, despite the fact that they are either given in compassionate use and or in a phase one trial, doesn't mean they work. And the critical issue is to balance the need for a therapeutic with a desperately ill person and the need to show that it actually works and that you don't hurt them. The other is convalescent plasma. First trials have been kicked off just a couple of days ago in Guinea and Sierra Leone and Liberia, which is going to be determining whether the antibodies in a person's plasma who has recovered will be protective. We have put together with the people in Emory as well as in Nebraska an adaptive trial design to take a look at a couple of these therapeutics with the control arm being an enhanced care. In other words, intensive intravenous replenishment and fluid and electrolyte balance. So it isn't a placebo because it's different than a situation in which you're giving a vaccine. So I'll stop there and hand it over back to Steve. I was in my, actually, 12 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Tony, and sorry for the glitch. Moncef, floor is yours.
Thank you, Steve. Thanks for the invitation. As you know, GSK has a long tradition of commitment to global health, whether on the R&D side of things through our 30 years commitment to a malaria vaccine, or now the work on Ebola or on tuberculosis vaccine, but also on the supply, manufacturer supply of approved vaccines through our partnership with Gavi. And we're very happy to be part of this endeavor to help deal with this and future Ebola outbreaks. And Tony, congratulations to you and to the NIH team for the great and leading job you're doing in actually driving the community to to participate, get involved, and help deal with this tragic situation, and potentially dramatically impactful, not only on the Western African countries where it's present, but on a worldwide basis. What I thought I'll do in the next few minutes is really talk about three things. One is share with you the status of our program. Mm-hmm. Two, talk about some key enablers that have been and are very important in helping us, and I think others, get incentivized to participate in this effort. And three, share some learnings and future-looking ideas on how we can be better prepared in the future to tackling situations like these. And then I'll be very happy to, of course, expand on any one of these dimensions as we get into the Q&A part. In terms of the status, well, we have a first phase one trial, as Tony described, in partnership with the NIH, that has been completed, and the data have been published, and I think they are very satisfactory, both in the safety, but also the kind of immune response induced. We also have three fully enrolled phase one studies being conducted in the UK, in Switzerland, and in Mali. The data of which, including their immune responses, will be available the second week of January. I say this with precision because our perspective is that we need to await the integrated analysis of all these trials to help us define what's the best dosage to use in the phase three trials in the field. We also are planning to start two large phase two trials in Africa, one in adults, including almost 3,000 subjects, and one in children in pediatric, involving about 800 subjects. They would also start around the middle of January. And then two phase three trials, one where we have a commitment with the NIH in Liberia to participate into the trial design that Tony briefly described, and then potentially also participate in the CDC-led trial in Sierra Leone. Those are the trials that we have planned. We also have a collaboration in discussion with J&J to see how we can not only have a good vaccine that can induce immunity and protect in the short term, but also have a very sustained protection over the long range by providing a booster vaccine by combining our vaccine with one of the vaccines that J&J is developing. So quite a comprehensive effort that should deliver data and information on the effectiveness of this vaccine before the middle of the year would be my prediction, if all goes well and these trials are executed as we hope they will, and as we're doing the best with the NIH and the CDC to help set them together. Now, running the trial cannot happen unless you manufacture the vaccine. Over the past 4 months, we have dedicated enormous resources from our organization to make sure that we take a bench level type process to manufacture the vaccine, which is where really it was, to a level where we can start producing a large amount of the vaccine. Our plans are to actually release the first lot for the phase three trial conduct before the end of the year. Actually, our date is December 23rd, if all goes well, touch wood. And then continue to produce doses of vaccine that are first into the tens of thousands per month, and then as of the spring into the hundreds of thousands per month, and then as of the fall of 2015 into the million per month, to potentially participate into mass vaccination programs if they are deemed to be important. Some major challenges faced us and continue to face us in scaling up the production of this vaccine, things like just filling the vaccine into vials under sterile conditions, and the conditions required for this vaccine are very challenging to achieve without derailing the filling of other live viral vaccines that are very important and established for public health, like measles, mumps, rubella vaccine, or rotavirus vaccine, or others. Also, great partnership, as you have alluded to, with the regulatory agencies to ensure that we have the highest standard of scientific stringency, but at the same time, the fastest possible track to the release of the vaccine dose and making them available for usage. So that's on the status of the vaccine. On the enablers, I think some very important point. First, this vaccine would not have been possible for any one of the vaccines that are being developed without partnership, whether it's a partnership with the NIH, partnership with BARDA. We have a partnership with the University of Lausanne, partnership with the University of Oxford as far as we're concerned, partnership with, between pharmaceutical companies. And I think it's really key, as Tony alluded to, I was talking at the NIH director meeting last week, that the companies here forget the competitive dimensions and really work together towards achievement of an impact on global health. That's one. I think the second thing that's very important is to think forward about access and making these vaccines deliverable to the populations that need them. And I'm very pleased that Gavi board came to the conclusions that they have to make the funds available for these vaccines to be provided. And I think the third dimension has been this critical meeting that took place at WHO late in October to make sure that all stakeholders around the table come to more or less a common view, and it's very difficult to have that many countries come to a singular conclusion, as well as companies, as well as key stakeholders. MSF was there, J&J was there, we were there, Merck was there, and many, many countries and donor countries. But I think it was a very important moment to coalesce our efforts and help us just align them into the right direction. And then the last point around enablers, and it's not an easy and simple one, is one around liability, indemnification, immunity for all the stakeholders involved into this endeavor. One of my concerns is that when this vaccine will be introduced, whether in clinical trial, but even more importantly, in a mass vaccination setting, in a country where pharmacovigilance is very limited, where many, many concomitant diseases exist, malaria, rotavirus, diarrhea, tuberculosis, you name it, a number of parasitic infections, events happen in the population all the time that are unrelated to Ebola. They will happen concomitantly with immunization with any vaccine. And how are we going to be able to decipher which of these events are related to the immunization and which are the background of events happening in the population is a major focus that we need to have. And could have consequences around liability claims that we need to really tackle. And we were very, very pleased by the US government decision to extend the PrEP Act to the Ebola vaccine. I think it's very important to deal with the situation in the US, but it's very important that other countries where such liability can materialize also take such actions. Finally, very briefly on the future perspective, this is, in the past 4 or 5 years, the fourth, at least, major bio threat, you know, the pandemic, SARS, anthrax, Ebola, God knows what's going to be next. And every time, the community is taken by quote-unquote surprise, where we have to really divert our resources that are dedicated, whether to discovering other vaccines or manufacturing existing vaccines, or whatever it is that we're doing to under emergency situation, either manufacture a vaccine that we know how to do or actually accelerate, like we're doing here, dramatically the development and supply of a vaccine, as we're doing for Ebola. We think, and we are discussing with various parties, that we should have a more proactive approach to this. We should set ourselves to have an organization, an infrastructure, and an approach that can pre-prepare technically various technologies for immunization and vaccination to be highly accelerated for a particular need, when unfortunately the need arises, starting from discovering vaccines against a number of pathogens that are on various existing lists of potential threats, to having the facilities to manufacture them. Because one of the things that we need to be very cautious about is the opportunity cost that these events represent for the industry and for the community in general. When we do them this way, we're highly inefficient, but also we let go of other programs that are also very important for public health, and we need to really find a more efficient way. So I'd like to conclude just by saying that, like in other instances, our company is 100% committed to making this vaccine available, to work with all the stakeholders, all the companies. Our intent here is absolutely not one of return on investment, but one of assuming our social responsibility. And hopefully we will all together be able to tackle this and future outbreaks.
Thank you very much, Moncef.
I didn't count, but it's more or less.
I think you're in the boundaries. I think you're there. Johan.
Okay, I do have a presentation.
Yes, please.
This one?
This one.
Okay. Great. Well, first of all, thank you very much. I'm really very pleased to be here today to give you an update on the Janssen Ebola vaccine. And before doing that, I really would like to echo what Moncef has really said. It's very clear that through this devastating disease, I really see a lot of sympathy and working together across all stakeholders. And I'm really pleased to see that indeed there are no borders between companies. And we really want to join efforts to make this fight successful. And without all of the stakeholders joining efforts, this certainly we would not have been able to be where we are today. Now, Johnson & Johnson, as you know, is a global healthcare company, and we actually, since the start of the crisis back in during summer, we realized that as part of our corporate responsibility and in line with the mission of our global public health organization, we really wanted to leverage all of the capabilities and know-how we have internally to fight this disease. Today, I will focus on vaccine, but also we have heavy investments, heavy activity ongoing in the area of developing treatment, looking at nucleosides that would be active on the virus. And also in terms of diagnostics, we know that today and going forward, certainly also in efficacy trials, it will be very important to have bedside diagnostics that allow you within minutes to know whether a patient that you're confronted with carries the Ebola virus or not. So these are really areas that we are very active in. Beyond that one, we also are very active in our philanthropic efforts and have collaborations with several NGOs, such as Project Hope, the CDC Foundation, and Partners in Health. When we look to the Janssen vaccine, and actually it was already briefly mentioned before, we actually have been working on this, and thanks to partnership with and sponsorship from NIH, where over the years we have been working with several generations of vaccines. And we actually, just before summer, came to a vaccination schedule that was shown to be 100% protective when a highly stringent virus challenge model was used in non-human primates. And what you see here is actually that there were three vaccination regimens that turned out to be 100% protective. One involved platforms that we have fully in-house, which is Adeno 26 and Adeno 35. The other one was priming with Adeno 26 or boosting with MVA or vice versa, priming with MVA and boosting with Adeno 26. As you can see in the graphs below, all of the animals that are vaccinated with placebo die within days, while there's full survival of the animals which were vaccinated. In view of the emergency, we decided at that moment that we really wanted to accelerate this development. The development was initially focused on a multivalent vaccine, but we knew very clearly that if we would focus on a single valent vaccine, focusing the Ebola strain, that we could go faster. In addition, by ourselves focusing on one of the vaccines and seeking a partner that could produce the other one, we also felt that we could shorten the timeline significantly. And that's indeed what we have achieved. What we actually have is that the vaccination schedule itself composes of two doses. There's a prime being given with an Adeno vector and a boost being given with the Bavarian Nordic MVA. The principle is that we are convinced that to have optimal robust protection and durable protection, that you really need that combination of the prime dose and the booster dose. One of the advantages of the platforms that we use is that both of these platforms have already been used extensively in the clinic, but also in commercial product. The Bavarian Nordic MVA is used already in the pox virus, and there are more than 7,000 subjects vaccinated to date. We have a very satisfying immunogenicity and safety profile. And also, our adenovectors have shown to be well tolerated in the different programs we have, like HIV, tuberculosis, and malaria. We actually selected those. We also selected the dose that, based on our past experience, is known to give good immunogenicity. Of course, we will have to wait what the immunogenicity is once we conduct the trial with this specific insert. One advantage that we see in this is that the work we have invested in these platforms over the past years have helped us to optimize the manufacturing process. Just to give you an example, at a pilot scale of 2 times 10 liters, we have about the yield of at least 150,000 doses that we now have for 5 consecutive runs. So we already have a substantial amount of vaccine in the freezer that can be released by March of next year. Production of MVA is ongoing as we speak, and the first results we hear from Denmark is that the yields are in line with expectations, such that we are confident that we will be able to release 500,000 doses by early March of next year. An important aspect also is that formulation work has been conducted on these vaccines in the past, and that at least these are data for using this platform, but with other inserts, we have seen that the product is thermal stable for an adeno platform up to 2 years to 8 degrees. For MVA, it's up to 1 year. It means that logistically would allow eventually to dispatch the vaccine in a frozen way, but locally could be using the classical distribution channels for the vaccines that already have to be at 2 to 8 degrees. This is just a schematic scheme of how it looks. The important factor is that it's an heterologous prime boost. One of the reasons for that being heterologous is indeed that you avoid immunity against initial vector, but certainly there's much more complex immune systems behind this that necessitate or bring the benefit of an heterologous prime boost. Where we are today is that we actually, and coincidence is that our batch release is also December 23rd, next week, and we are actually in discussions with the center in Oxford, and we really want to have the first patients dosed the very early days of January. Everything is aligned to make this happen, and we will actually accelerate also the readout of this post-dose one. Those data should become available somewhere by mid-February, such that in that time frame we can start thinking around participating to a trial that would allow us to assess the efficacy. With regard to production, the current thinking, the current plans are to produce at least 1 million doses for next year, but recent evaluation and also based on the recent yields, if need would be, we could go up for next year up to 5 million doses, and the year after at larger scale would be more in the order of magnitude of 15 to 20 million doses. And that's actually what I wanted to say. Again, I would like to stress that, as Moncef has indicated, we are convinced that we should go beyond the borders of the companies here. We really should work together with all stakeholders to be successful in this fight. And I also hope that when I see how this partnership with all stakeholders works well now and how it has helped us to compress timelines from years into months, I hope that also this teaches us a lesson going forward and that we can repeat this in other areas where there's also high unmet need. Thank you.
Thank you. Julie Gerberding, President of Merck Vaccines. Julie.
Thank you. And thank you so much for hosting this and to my co-panelists for their contributions and their partnerships as we try to work through this. I thought what I would do is maybe try to put a little more context around some of the things that we're talking about as we open this up for conversation at the end of our discussion. One of the things that I reflect on is that this is a predictable surprise. You know, this is a zoonotic disease, meaning this is a disease that emanated from contact with probably bats that harbor the virus, and that virus spilled over into other mammalian species. Sometimes it spills over directly into people. But we've known about this zoonotic ecosystem for a long time. We didn't know that it had reached the west coast of Africa in quite the way it did, but it's there now. And there's no reason to believe that we're not going to see this again. So we have to be fully prepared for the possibility that even if we're able to quench the particular outbreak that we're experiencing, that this is not the last time we're going to be dealing with Ebola. I don't mean to sound like a pessimist, but I think it's very important to have that longer-term perspective on what lies ahead of us with respect to zoonotic diseases, and this one in particular. I think we also need to really think about the issue of plausibility. from everything you've heard and everything we've seen in the preclinical and the early clinical studies that are going on, creating a vaccine for this pathogen is biologically plausible. And that gives me a great deal of optimism that even if the 1.0 vaccines that we're working on today don't prove to be the best vaccine or the ultimate vaccine, we need to keep going because it is plausible to develop a safe and effective vaccine that really can prevent infection either pre or post exposure. And that's something that we need to just stay the course, tenaciously stick to and solve for it. With respect to the vaccine that Merck is partnering with, these are early days. The VSV virus is a virus that is designed so that there's active cycles of replication of the vaccine vector when it's in the human host, and that has the advantage perhaps of prompting a robust immune system fast. We have to watch carefully for side effects. The arthralgias that were reported from one study site weren't particularly worrisome, but that's why we do clinical studies and phase one and phase two studies, so that we are alert to things that could signal reactogenicity or something that would be a harbinger of a more serious issue down the road. I think we also anticipate that the creation of a solution to this is going to have to be pragmatic. Lives are at stake today while we're sitting here having this scientific conversation, and we can't move at the pace that we're used to moving at. I don't know how to speak for my colleagues in the other manufacturing pharmaceutical companies, but this is an incredible disruptor of business as usual, because we have to be pragmatic. We can't take our time. We can't have lots of conference calls and meetings and, you know, do all the stakeholder and key opinion leader engagement and on and on and on. Can't do things in series. We have to do them in parallel. So we have to be willing to work faster, to move more people, mobilize more people, to really come to the table inside the company, let alone what's going on with the incredible partnerships that we're experiencing outside the company. But I can just tell you, I think you said it really well about the disturbance of other important pharmaceutical work that would otherwise be going on. The pull of this vaccine incites the passion of people, certainly in the vaccine business, but across the entire enterprise of Merck. I mean, we're passionate about this. We know it's the right thing to do. We know we have something to contribute. We know we can't do it alone. And people are leaning in to the opportunity to be a part of this process. But at the same time, we didn't budget for this. We didn't structure our company for this. This just came along as a sudden requirement, and we have to step up to the plate and do our share. But it comes at an opportunity cost that is something that we feel we have concerns about. It doesn't change our commitment, but it is something that we have to factor into it, and it's something we need to plan better for going forward into the future. This challenge that we're facing is also about unprecedented partnerships, but I think in this world where we're always talking about public-private partnerships, and you know that's kind of a buzzword, there's some very special partnerships that are going on here, and one of them is the partnership between people who are traditionally competitors. But there's a much more robust set of partnerships happening between people who may share a broad agenda but who aren't used to working for each other. The transnational government partnerships, even in the U.S. government, the incredible partnership with BARDA at the leadership, with the NIH, with CDC, with Gavi. I mean, how wonderful is it that Gavi has already made a commitment to make sure that this vaccine will be available to the people who need it most by creating a macro investment commitment to bring it forward. I think what the beauty of that to me is the fact that underlying this kind of glaring public health requirement is the trust that's been developed in the past several years as we've worked together on other problems. And so we have developed some understanding of how each other works and some appreciation for who has a stake in what, and are willing to sort of build on that trust and connect these partnerships, even when there's enormous uncertainty about where this is going to land and where we will ultimately end up. The last thing I wanted to really talk about was sort of poignancy. The fact is, this is about 18,000 people who've had Ebola, about 35% who are no longer with us, but it's also about, you know, the whole milieu in which they live and shared their lives and their families and their memories and their loved ones, people who have suffered deeply from this tragic outbreak. And the poignancy of being where we are today in the context of a predictable surprise and not being able to do more faster to really contain this outbreak and make their lives more secure and reduce the incredible human suffering that surrounds us, not just for the directly affected people, but for all the people in the communities who don't have health services and whose lives have been so disrupted and whose economies have been so disrupted and potentially whose democracies are going to be so disrupted. But the other poignancy to me, and because I don't work for the government anymore, I can say this, is the poignancy of having been here and done this before. We do not have to keep reinventing the wheel. How many SARS outbreaks do we need to have? How many MERS? How many public health infectious disease outbreaks on a global scale do we need to experience before we recognize that we can't have an ectopic response? We have to have a sustained commitment, and we have to stick with it even when whatever the precipitating problem was goes away. To me, that's, in a sense, the ultimate poignancy, and I really share with you your final remarks about we need to lean into the future here, create new avenues, new tools, new partnerships to be able to sustain this effort over the long run, because I don't want to have to sit on a panel like this again, as much as I've enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Julia. It's very eloquent. Rohit Malpani, MSF.
Thanks very much, and I really appreciate being invited to join this panel today. Doctors Without Borders and Medicine Sans Frontier has been responding to this outbreak really since the start and raising the alarm and looking for more resources, especially in terms of teams and infrastructure. Very early on, we also realized, as we often do with many of the emergencies we're responding to, that we simply do not have the tools we need, whether we talk of vaccines or drugs or diagnostics. So we've taken a very pragmatic approach to try to really deal with this outbreak in a way that our healthcare workers, more who have died in this than in any other response that MSF has given before, as well as affected communities, can get the best outcomes. So just quickly to talk about some of the things that MSF is doing vis-a-vis trials, we are going to be launching at least two of the trials before Christmas this year for some of the drugs that Tony had put on his slides, and that's for favipiravir and brindisopavir. And we also are going to run a third trial using convalescent plasma. And our criteria very much was simply based on whatever safety and efficacy data we had, as well as simply having supply available. And that certainly has excluded use of some of the monoclonal antibodies and especially ZMAP, since there's not a lot of supply. One thing that I've been especially involved in is some of the safeguarding of access issues that we consider very important, both in terms of the immediate term and ensuring that we can use these drugs also for emergency or compassionate use for other patients outside of the trial, since we certainly don't want to have differential outcomes for patients that are either within a trial or just are simply in the community. We certainly are also concerned about the medium-term access issues in terms of if a trial is proven to be successful, that we can continue to ensure that there's supply available to the patients if this outbreak indeed continues, as Julie is noting. And certainly, we're also very concerned about the long-term access issues in terms of registration of these products, in terms of adequate supply, in terms of the affordability of these products and the management of intellectual property. And this is especially important because, as Julie was noting, this is unfortunately something that's going to keep coming back. And we are not sure as an organization in the future if all of these other responders will be there, or if it will simply be MSF in these communities that will have to respond. And we will need access to these products in the future. So we need to take steps now to ensure that we can safeguard long-term access. In terms of vaccines, again, very early on, alongside others in the global health community, we very much were thinking about the importance of vaccination potentially to turn the tide of the Ebola outbreak, and have been engaged in pragmatic advocacy, really, to pull out all the stops in terms of really accelerating the trials and also in terms of accelerating the production, recognizing that both for the companies and for donors that this would entail certain risks to be taken in the short term and in the medium term. So we've certainly tried to take a very pragmatic approach to that. And we really do welcome the commitments that have been made at Gavi, although we do have some short-term concerns, I guess, in terms of the, let's say, structure that's been put forward. One is certainly around potentially the price of the vaccines, which has not been specified actually in the strategy that has been put forward. It's been left to be very vague. And to the extent that we think these vaccines should be available very close to their marginal costs is something that we hope Gavi can achieve. Related to that is certainly that we would like to avoid overpayments for these vaccines. There is a lot of contributions that the companies are making. There's also a lot of contributions that governments are making to actually help to pay for these vaccines, and we certainly support direct compensation for the investments companies are making insofar then that we can ensure that the vaccines are available at its marginal cost. And we should also remember that there are other incentives that are being introduced to potentially reward companies for development of these vaccines, including the priority review voucher in the United States, which can be a very important sum of money to encourage companies to develop vaccines or drugs against specific neglected diseases. And Congress has just amended the legislation to include Ebola. So these are all very important incentives, but we need to be sure in terms of how this funding is being provided and to make sure it's well coordinated as we have been discussing. And the last issue is certainly about equitable distribution. We do see that we are moving towards industrial scale production for a lot of these vaccines, but in the shorter or medium term, there will be some problems in terms of providing adequate supply. And to the extent that we discover these vaccines are safe and effective, we want to make sure that they are prioritized for the affected communities. We know that there will be other interests in terms of securing supply, let's say, potentially for developed countries, but there's also issues in terms of how do you manage the distribution between different affected communities, and we hope the WHO is able to take a central role. As an organization, we are considering developing a clinical trial in Guinea with the government of Norway and other partners that we hope we can get off the ground by next March. Moving now into issues around second-generation products, which we think is very important. Certainly in terms of vaccines, we would like to see a future vaccine to be more thermostable. This is a challenge for MSF for many of the products that the companies on this stage are currently selling to us, in that we are often unable to deliver them in very remote settings because we simply cannot move them out of the cold chain and to a controlled temperature chain. So we hope a future vaccine is able to address some of those issues. In terms of drugs, and with the monoclonal antibodies, we do think they show a lot of promise, and there's a lot of interest in MSF to use these drugs. We are concerned over potentially the use of biological samples from affected populations in order to develop these products. It's potentially a concern that has arisen for us internally. So we simply want to ensure that if materials are being used from affected countries, that various concerns around access are triggered in terms of managing the supply. And of course, we want to ensure that there's affordability of these products and that they're available again in a sufficient supply for the affected countries. And to, just perhaps to end on some remarks, and just to note also that for monoclonal antibodies, actually, the U.S. has expanded the orphan tax drug credit to include the development of these monoclonal antibodies, which pays for 50% of the clinical trial costs, but doesn't actually safeguard any of the access issues which we're concerned upon. So demanding that it should be affordable, that they should be available in sufficient supply. That's also a concern we have with the priority review voucher and really with all of the funding that's being provided. It seems like none of that is being tied to actually ensuring access, which really matters for our organization, because in the long term, ultimately, we're going to be responsible for acquiring those products and using them in the field for our patients. Just to end in terms of some additional thoughts, I mean, three lessons for us certainly in responding to this outbreak in terms of the drugs and vaccines. One is certainly about the challenge we continue to have in really insisting on the importance of access, whether we're talking about the shorter, medium term, or long term, that funding that governments are providing need to be linked to these access issues. Our clinical trial partners often are not as familiar with these issues because it's not the course to think about these issues in clinical trials, and it's not normal actually for MSF to be engaged in clinical trials, but this is front and center for us as an operational organization that's in the field trying to deliver treatments in the long term. So there's certainly a lot of challenges there to normalize this more in clinical development, I think, now and in the future. A second thing is certainly around transparency, especially of funding. There's a lot of money that's being put towards this, and that's important to move from, sort of from the famine to feast. But we think that we need to understand better how this funding is being spent, what conditions are attached to it, and how it all works together. And certainly that's especially important for the US government, which is offering so much money from different sources towards the response, but for which there's often not a lot of clarity for us as an organization. The last issue I note is simply this issue of the failure of our system of research and development. I work for an entity called the Access Campaign, which our organization launched in 1999 because we were concerned that our system of research and development does not ensure that drugs and vaccines are affordable, that they're suited to the conditions in which we work, and that they simply do not exist. And that is what this outbreak represents to us. It is simply we are faced with the same situation we had 15 years ago. And this systemic failure is something we all own as a global community, and it is something which we have still not responded to. When you look at the vaccine, the VSV vaccine, which Merck has now licensed in, that was developed by the Canadian government many years ago and was licensed actually to a small manufacturer for $200,000 Canadian, to which nothing was done then for a long period of time until this current outbreak. That is a failure. When I hear comments, unfortunately, of saying that this is an opportunity cost or this was not expected as business as usual, that confirms our concerns. Ebola is a concern for us. It is a public health problem, and it needs to be front and center. We need to have new incentives that try to prioritize these diseases. They should not be seen as opportunity costs. They need to be seen front and center as part of our global response and as our system of innovation. And that is really what's required to have changes in the future. This is an emergency, but so are other things. So is drug-resistant TB, so is basic antibiotic resistance, so is a range of 17 other neglected diseases, and all of these merit our attention, but they require new ways of thinking and new ways of research and development. And it's only if we can find new ways to actually develop drugs and vaccines are we going to prevent being on these panels in the future, because we are going to continue to face these challenges. And as an operational organization, we're going to have to continue to respond and put our staff into see affected communities suffering so greatly as they have in this outbreak. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rohit. It's really striking how much soul-searching and introspection this crisis has stirred, and how much efforts at innovation and changing business practices and modes of operation, how much all of you have been stretched in this period to do things that are outside the normal pattern. There's three issues I'd like to quickly touch on and then open to the audience. One is the question of how these trials can be best carried forward. There is a debate going on now. There would be, in an ideal situation, an obvious preference for the classic randomized trial approach, double-blind trial. And that will be attempted in many settings as we go forward. There's uncertainty, though, that we know the risk environment is complicated. We know the operational environment is complicated. We know that the acceptance by communities is very fundamental in being able to move forward with trials. And so it seems to me that as we're entering 2015 with multiple expanded trials, that this unresolved debate around how do you operate with greatest adherence to principles of safety and efficacy while being pragmatic and adaptive to a highly challenging and highly urgent environment, how is that likely to play through? It's an honest and open set of challenges for which I don't know that there's any immediate and clear answer, but it would be useful to hear from all of you how you anticipate navigating the environment and moving forward. Tony, do you want to say a few words
Sure.
about that?
So, first of all, when you're dealing with trials, there is the balance, as I said in my brief opening remarks, about trying to get a product that potentially is going to be beneficial to people as quickly as you can, while making sure it is beneficial and not harmful. And that's really the fundamental rationale for a randomized controlled placebo double-blind trial. I think that can only be done with complete buy-in by the people involved and those responsible for them, which is the reason why we're now in our fourth visit to Liberia in discussion with the Liberian health authorities about the feasibility and the advisability or not, and the decision is or, as opposed to or not, to do a randomized controlled trial, fully being aware that the advantage of doing a placebo-controlled trial where not every single person gets the product is that from the standpoint of proving efficacy or not, it is really the only surefire way of doing that.
You can have other trials, you can have cluster randomization, you could have step wedge, which are actually okay, but they're much less stringent from the standpoint of getting the data. The advantage of the other trials is that you can get, everybody will ultimately get the vaccine. So if it works, that's good. The other trial, the randomized trial, you can probably get an answer of efficacy more quickly. Once you get the efficacy, you're going to distribute that vaccine to everybody and anybody who might benefit from it. So there's the balance that ultimately, if it works, everyone is going to get it. That's the framework. Then you look at the advantages and the disadvantages. If, in fact, you're distributing a vaccine before you know it works, the advantage is that if it does work, you get it to people quickly. The disadvantage is that you may not ever prove that it does work. So when we're going to be sitting on this panel with the inevitable next outbreak, we will not know if we have a vaccine that works. That's the problem. The issue with a randomized controlled placebo trial is that some people are not getting it right away, and there is this absolute understandable desire that if something is going to be beneficial, get it to there as quickly as possible. I gave, and I'll just finish with this because it's very important. I mentioned this at another seminar we had here about the issue of the difference between therapies that you make readily available, for which I was the champion of during the HIV/AIDS, versus a vaccine that you don't know works. And there's a big difference there, because in one, you're giving it to people who are perfectly normal, in others, you're giving it to people who have a terrible illness. And the thing that I will never forget, as I mentioned, and people may have heard of this, is that we had a vaccine for HIV that looked really good in an animal model. It passed phase one, was really safe, no prohibitive adverse events, and even went into phase 2A and looked good. Mm-hmm. So the decision was that if you look at Ebola, as dramatic as it is, 7,000-8,000 people have died from Ebola. Over the last 4 days, 16,000 people have died from AIDS. So you could have made the argument, as soon as you had that safety data in the HIV trial, give it to everybody who needs it, because it's a terrible, catastrophic pandemic. The only trouble is, in the randomized control, double-blind trial, we found out that there was a 41% increased risk of getting HIV infected if you were vaccinated with the vaccine. And it had nothing to do with behavioral changes. It had to do with the vaccine. So that's one of the reasons why, when you're dealing with giving something to someone who is an otherwise normal person, even though they're at great risk, seriously balance. And I don't know, Steve, what the right answer is, but I do know that you at least need to seriously consider the pros and the cons. And that consideration has to be with the people in the country who are going to be involved with the vaccine. And if they don't want it, they shouldn't get it. They should get whatever trial they feel is appropriate for them.
So we're in a negotiation. We're balancing out the urgency, the operational environment, the demands from the community and the leadership itself. And that is all to be determined as far as the mix of tools and approaches. Would you like to say something, Monsieur?
Yeah, I think I'm very supportive of the view that Tony is expressing. And I'd like to add two dimensions to it. Malaria kills between 12 and 18,000 children every hour. And we need to be very cognizant of the proportionality that we're talking about. A very important point regarding Ebola is, in January, February, March, April, the world doesn't have enough vaccine doses to immunize everybody. And the issue of having people at risk who are normal subjects but are at risk of acquiring Ebola will exist outside of the clinical trial design. This is not a situation where we could potentially immunize the whole population. Even if we wanted, we couldn't. So there will be people who participate into the trial and people who don't. And I think the ethical question on keeping people away from a vaccine that could have protected them could be extended to the overall population. For me, it's one of the reasons why I'm saying, you know, pragmatically, there's nothing else we can do than providing this vaccine to a smaller proportion of the population. But of course, engaging, explaining, and having the agreement is absolutely paramount. It's also the reason why we are not favoring any one of the trial designs that are being put forward, and we're working very hard to make vaccine available for all of them. We don't know which one will make it. I do have a concern, if you look at what's happening in Liberia, that had we introduced the vaccine a month ago, we would be thinking that the decrease in events now is related to the vaccine when it's related to other things, and therefore we wouldn't know. We actually would think the vaccine worked, but we wouldn't know, and we may be wrong for the future. So I think we need to have a very balanced, very participative, very open, but also scientifically sound discussion around this.
Johan.
This is really hard, and I just want to jump in here with perspective, because I completely agree with Tony, and I think participatory is the concept that needs to be emphasized. It's one thing to sit, you know, in a corporate headquarters and think we know the best way forward. It's a completely different thing to have a conversation with the people who are on the front line or the people who are in the affected countries who see medicine very differently than we do and have a whole different cultural context in which they make decisions. So that participatory element is really important. And probably the thing that worries me is that even if we knew the vaccine worked, will people take it? That's a problem that we see with vaccines that have been around for as long as polio vaccine has been around. We have this incredible vaccine hesitancy, and when a disease is as frightening as Ebola is, I think it's going to be very difficult to help a population have trust and confidence in the product. So the more participatory the decision process, the more transparent we all are, I think the better likelihood we are to bring whatever we can find that's helpful to actually be at the front line where people need it.
No, I fully concur. I think the major challenge, as it has been said, is will it be accepted by the local population? Not only having authorization of local ethical committees, but really getting the acceptance of the people that participate to the trial and being well prepared that if issues arise during the trial, that there will be Ebola cases anyway, that it can be approached in a very objective way. And you can avoid mass history that would start accusing the vaccine or so whatever. So I do think that the social thinking around how to involve the study population and to work up when issues do arise will be very important to make these trials successful. One thing that I would like to add to that for a vaccine who comes a few months later is on how we will go later on demonstrating for the later vaccines whether there's efficacy or not, whether we will have to go to randomized trials again, which, when there's an effective vaccine, becomes even more controversial, or whether we should really start looking into immunological bridging combined with non-human primate data or whatever. But there's certainly a discussion that we will soon need to have.
Rohit, MSF is, of all the organizations here, is the one with the deepest on the ground close in, extended contact and knowledge. Yeah. And I'm sure you're pulled in divergent directions in terms of this issue around ethics and trials and community relationships. How do you see this?
Well, I mean, the basic summary is what others are saying, which is it is about community engagement and community acceptance, and we are built basically on that basis. So that's just part of the DNA of the organization. It's not something just to be said. We haven't finished, I believe now, the trial design for the vaccines. We have made a decision for our trials on drugs not to introduce randomized trials. It simply was a decision that was taken very early on in the organization that this was something as a medical provider that we would be unable to do. And we are instead relying on, again, on approaches that have been criticized elsewhere to look instead at the historic trends in some of these communities in terms of what has been the outcomes in terms of mortality rates, and there is an understanding of the shortcomings, but also as a medical provider, it is. And again, it's because it is new for us to be engaged in trials. We simply do not feel that we would be able to engage in a randomized controlled trial for the drugs. But again, for vaccines, I believe there are discussions of ways of trying to, and again, for drugs, because there's no equipoise, there's no reasons equipoise. In which you,
Right.
So, Steve, again, the point you made is an excellent point. There is a big difference, and people should need to understand that between a drug for someone who's sick versus a vaccine. So there's no criticism of design of trials that can be anything from adaptive trial to any kind of trial. You need to really do what's acceptable and what you feel is the best. So there's no space between us on that.
Now, one of the issues that has surfaced in this period is coordination, how to make sense, how to track and coordinate efforts. Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, took this step last week when its board met to put itself forward. I'd like to ask Natasha Villamora from Gavi to just say a few words. There's a microphone right here. Around how does this step help put in place mechanisms that build confidence around the coordinated effort looking forward?
Sure.
Can you explain a bit about that, Natasha?
I will do my best. But thank you, Steve, for hosting this panel. And it's a terrific group of people that are really in the middle of all of this right now. So it's great to be here. So just to give everyone a little bit of background, in September, our executive committee of the board asked the Secretariat to basically look at ways that Gavi could potentially have a role in the Ebola outbreak and in the crisis. And basically, over the last 2 months, there has been a tremendous amount of work that has been done over this period, a lot of work with all of the people on the panel and pretty much every stakeholder that's involved in this process. And that all came to a point at our board last Thursday where the board discussed the idea of what that role would be. And the decision was a couple of things. The first was that everybody is related is this a funding envelope of up to $300 million for the procurement of an Ebola vaccine once it's been deemed safe and effective by the WHO. And then there's also another up to a $90 million envelope for two purposes. One is around the rollout of a vaccine once it becomes available, and then the other piece is around recovery of immunization systems. I think everybody is aware that, especially in the three countries that have been affected, immunization systems have been decimated. A huge reduction in immunization, and when the time is right, these countries are going to have to rebuild, and we are going to be part of that solution for them. I think it's very important for people to understand. I think some people here know that we are just weeks away from our second replenishment, which is not about Ebola. The number that we're looking for is $7.5 billion, and that was well before this crisis hit. So the numbers that we're talking about for Ebola are in addition to what we're looking for replenishment. I think it's very important to know that that funding is additive and not part of our regular critical immunization work. What we're doing as far as next steps, I mean, we literally just made this decision 4 days ago, but the work has already started to really get ourselves in place to be ready when a vaccine comes about. So four work streams have been created around the areas of the board decision, so procurement, rollout, future outbreak, and the recovery of the system. So we're really working to ensure that these pieces are all set so that when a vaccine becomes available, we're prepared to roll it out. And as far as the recovery piece goes, as I said, I think countries are still in process of figuring out what they need to do, and we're putting ourselves together so that when countries are ready to start rebuilding, that we're really there to support it. And, I think what has happened in the last 2 months really shows the important role that Gavi has around immunizations, but also around strengthening health systems around immunization. And we're a small piece, but I think, you know, just kind of going back to what everybody said, but in particular, Dr. Gerberding, around partnership. You know, we will play a certain role in the vaccine process, but in order to ensure that it's really getting to the people that need it, you know, we will rely on our partners on the ground along with all of the other folks that are part of this process. So.
Thank you very much, Natasha. There seemed to be a pretty strong consensus among the speakers that future business needs to be done on a different basis, and that part of this introspection process is looking ahead with that in mind. Could we get a little more particular around, a little more concrete as to what actually would you see as the essential changes in practices, in coordinating mechanisms, in planning, and creating incentives? Julie?
Well, one thing I think we would all agree on is that companies crave predictability. So we like to have the confidence that if we start something, we can move it to its completion. We'd like to have the confidence that if, for example, we have a government partnership, that partnership is good to the duration of whatever it is that we're trying to do and not something that's going to go away with the next election or the next sequestration or the next, you know, challenging circumstances in anybody's government. So I think that's one aspect of it, is the kind of the confidence that if we're going to make an investment in a partnership, that the partnership can hold. And I think we have good examples where that's happened. So I think BARDA has come through on its commitments, and I'm not criticizing anyway. I'm just saying that is a necessary component of this. I actually think all of us would benefit from a public that is more informed and more reliably informed about why these kinds of investments are important. You know, we just heard Gavi say that we have a pledging conference and people need to commit, governments need to commit, donors need to commit. And in order for that to happen, publics have to really understand what is the value proposition that we're creating and why is it important to vaccinate, and what is the benefit that not only the children or adolescents who are benefiting from immunization, or in the case of Ebola, all the people who benefit, what's the benefit to the people who don't have affordable access, but what is the advantage to the rest of us? And I think it's important that we not be shy from the fact that vaccines and vaccination is an important public health good, and the commons that sharing that good has become very global, and we're only, you know, one traveler away from a threat in our own neighborhood if we don't do a good job assuring affordable access to the whole community. But I think in terms of how we develop pipelines of vaccines, one of the areas for opportunity that we're exploring, not just in the context of Ebola, but for many of the other so-called neglected diseases or hard to find treatments and vaccines for diseases, is the pre-competitive collaboration. There are increasingly very interesting places where companies can come together and work on projects, bring different ideas together, long before there's a product or a candidate target, so that we kind of can share in our own intellectual capabilities, but also partner with the people in academia or in other kinds of companies and nonprofit organizations to bring the best ideas forward long before we are targeting a product. And for neglected diseases, that's probably really the only way to harvest that intellectual competency and expedite its useful fruition.
Why don't we hear from the other two industry representatives on? Yeah. Well, we're hearing from industry here. And then
so something that our company is extremely committed to from our track record, as you know, we have some very specific ideas around what we should do going forward. Because there are the vaccines that exist, but there are those that don't. Those that exist, I think all the companies have approaches to ensure access, and obviously Gavi is playing a fundamental role in providing that predictability and that sustainability that allows for very low prices to be available for access in the least developed world. I think the challenge actually is how to incentivize innovation and very high risk investments to go into areas of diseases that may or may not someday come. Mm-hmm. The key elements as we live it through, and every time there was an outbreak, we did, is speed and volume. And frankly, in all the outbreaks that have, or pandemic that have scares that occurred, we are very fortunate that none of them actually turned out to be one. So we actually don't know whether we're prepared or not. So we need to be very careful as a society to be much more prepared, frankly. So the way we look at it is that, at least as vaccines are concerned, is that vaccines work through what I would call platform technology. If I take any one of the vaccines you have seen there, the chimpanzee or the human adenovirus or the VSV virus or RNA as for adjuvants, there is a great technology that can be used to make many different vaccines. And in fact, we can predict with reasonable accuracy, but not total accuracy, which vector, which technology, which platform may be best suited to what kind of pathogen. So our recommendation is actually to create an organization, and exactly how we can organize it and how we should fund it and participate to it is open for debate. But create an organization that is going to identify 4, 5, or 6 such platforms and prepare them for scalability to gain that speed of reaction, and actually also use them to build vaccines for the predictable possible outbreaks, and have those vaccines available. But also, when we haven't predicted the pathogen, that this scalability, as I mm-hmm. call it, is built into the platform, so you can go actually really very fast.
So these collaborations would be a grand collaboration of a kind that you're talking about, in which different industrial interests would be sharing in this.
Potentially, but it can also be, frankly, it can be competitive or pre-competitive.
Yeah.
Both models are possible. There are very significant synergies between the way you design and develop a vaccine for Ebola and the way you design and develop a vaccine for another disease that's more commercially relevant to sustain a business that takes the risk of innovation like the vaccine industry does. And you know the knowledge you generate from one can serve the other and vice versa. Yeah. But I think there is a need for a concerted effort and an organization that's dedicated to this, because the other point is the following. I'd like to say the following, if I may. One of the points in this particular situation is that if a company didn't care about Ebola, nobody talk about it. There are vaccine companies that are not doing anything for the Ebola vaccine. We need to be careful that those who actually have made the commitment outside of any form of financial or any otherwise contribution from anybody to commit their resources to make these vaccines, to discover them, develop them, manufacture them, make them available, take all the risks that are taken, are not those that are pointed at. I think that's the first big picture context that we need to do and need not forget. Because what's very important is that this type of commitment to public health, to global health, to our social responsibility has to be sustained in the world we live in. In the world we live in, enormous investments are made in R&D. 90% of those investments in many cases fail, and in some cases they succeed, and we need to be able to sustain that innovation engine. So I think we need to have the courage at the same time to say we need to be a sustainable business, and at the same time, we will commit outside of any condition whenever public health needed to do it. That's what the companies should do, and frankly, that's what our company is doing every time we have the opportunity to do it. And what we're proposing is to do it on a grand scale for many, many more pathogens than we have up to now.
Thank you. Johan.
I think it's an excellent idea that Once you go into details, we'll need a lot of more discussion, but certainly I think both companies are quite similar in terms of corporate responsibility and social responsibility thinking. We do have a dedicated public health group, which actually is tasked to really do its R&D only on those type of projects. The only thing is you have to keep it in balance with the total portfolio, because you just can't afford to have too many of them. But certainly also there, we're looking into working together with a network of partners, being companies or being institutes, in the pre-competitive area. But I do think that part of the future is there. Part of the future, I think reference was made to the problem with antibiotics and multi-resistance, is also that the society need to start thinking differently on how drug-specific antibiotics are being compensated for. Because it's clear that with a normal price setting, it just does not work. You really need to look into other ways of incentivizing, not to make them hugely expensive, but that the overall effort in some way is being taken into account such that progress can be made in that field.
Thank you. I'm going to turn to Rohit and then Tony, and then we're going to open for questions and comments. Rohit, on this question of what needs to change, Tony?
So a few thoughts. We recognize the efforts that companies are making right now, and we certainly appreciate that. But if you take the example of GSK's vaccine, that was only acquired because you purchased a company called Okairos, and that was for another vaccine. And unfortunately, this was just sort of included in the package and sort of sat within the company. So we recognize the steps that have been taken now. But and of course, a lot of the other vaccines, the VSV vaccine was actually developed by the government of Canada through public funding, and it was already shown activity through their efforts, and there simply was nothing to be done. It's just to take a step back. I mean, the big picture about this is we only have one system of innovation today. That's the patent-based system of innovation, and that is something which all of these companies have pushed quite aggressively for over the decades and have globalized in the 1990s. And so in a sense, you own this system of innovation. This is what you asked for, and this is what we have today. And that is what we are actually having to deal with every day in the field. And that is one of the symptoms, or basically the results, is what we see with the Ebola outbreak today. And people can dispute that, but this is something, and again, where your companies today are still pushing now for higher and higher levels of intellectual property protection that we think are only deepening the problems we're seeing around the world instead of actually solving them. Now, in terms of the suggestions of things such as product development partnerships, or platforms. I mean, this was already something that has been introduced actually now almost 15 years ago. Our organization launched one of the first product development partnership in 2000, the Drugs for Neglected Diseases Initiative. We still pay for about 25% of its operating costs. So while we don't necessarily disagree with looking for these solutions to potentially develop technologies or platforms, for us it's really more of the same. There already is a lot of product development partnerships out there, and all we're seeing today is we're adding more and more of them to sort of paper over the cracks that we're seeing in our system of research and development. What we have been doing over the last decade is working at the World Health Organization and elsewhere to document the systemic failures we see in research and development, and the World Health Organization has come out with two comprehensive reports on this issue that show the extent to which our patent system is not developing drugs and vaccines and diagnostics that are needed in developing countries, and they have developed a range of recommendations to try to break this debate between innovation and access to ensure that we can have the public health tools that we need to respond to emergencies like this and the everyday problems we see in developing countries today. And there's a range of recommendations that talk about new models of innovation that move outside of the patent system, that seek to de-link the cost of research and development from the product price so that we can actually focus on actual public health needs to develop public health goods, which is essentially what we're doing here today with the Ebola vaccine. Through substantial public investments, through procurement mechanisms being put forward by Gavi, we are essentially developing these vaccines through new models of research and development. We're just doing it through a sort of, random and sort of stepwise process. But unfortunately, a lot of people in industry have been fighting against these new models of research and development because they challenge our existing system of R&D. And we have been continuing to advocate for this because we are concerned about the long-term impacts. We have already seen some success in the vaccine space, actually, with the meningitis A vaccine, which was developed through a collaboration of the Serum Institute, the National Institutes of Health, with financing from various partners, that developed an effective second-generation meningitis A vaccine at 50 cents a dose that essentially de-linked the cost of R&D from the product price. So this can be done, and we think it can be done in other areas. Our concern, though, is that the solutions that are coming out are just more of the same. The United States is completing negotiations of the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement at this time that simply seeks to introduce the highest levels of intellectual property protection in the Asia-Pacific region and eventually around the world. And none of that will deal with these problems. We simply will have more of the same problems. And to end, again, we do think that these new models are not just for Ebola, they're not just for neglected diseases, they can be for very basic things such as antibiotics. We basically have the United States saying that we cannot rely on industry with current models of innovation to develop the antibiotics we need even in our hospitals today, and we're going to need new models of innovation and substantial new forms of funding. We simply think that this can be applied on a much broader scale, and it's necessary not only for people here in the United States but around the world, because otherwise we're just going to continue to face these problems. But we need new ways of thinking. It's not just going to be the solutions we've used over the last decade because they're not getting the job done.
Thank you. Tony, what needs to change?
So Steve, first of all, the comments of my colleagues on the panel are all right on, and I agree completely with what people have said. So I'm just maybe make one or two very brief comments that is in a different area, fully knowing that I think what they said is probably the most important thing. And it's two things, and it has to do with something that we've been dealing with some time, and that is the issue of changing in the sense of making sure that we pay attention to something that has been started some time ago that has recently been crystallized in what has been called the global health security agenda. Mm-hmm. In other words, to try and develop some sort of an infrastructure in the developing world so that when you go in to a country for one reason or other, you leave some sustainable infrastructure that could be intellectual or could be physical, mostly intellectual and training, so that the countries involved, if we had had some sort of an infrastructure available in the Guinea, Liberia, Sierra Leone area when the first cases came out, to be able to do the kind of identification and isolation and contact tracing, we may not have had an outbreak as explosive as it was. It's very interesting, we've learned, we've had PEPFAR now since 2003, and PEPFAR has not only had a major impact on HIV, but has also left in countries an extraordinary infrastructure of people committed to the health of that nation that has now transcended HIV in a way that involves a variety of other diseases, maternal health, child health, vaccinations for individuals, measles programs, et cetera. We really need to pay attention to that because I have extraordinary respect and admiration for the courageous and amazing things that Médecins Sans Frontières does, but the cavalry can't keep coming in at every single time because they only have a limited amount of resources to do that. So we need to start developing some ingrown groups that can do that. The other thing is just, I couldn't help but think when you were talking about, we all said it, but I know Julie said it right off, that these are surprises that are not surprises. And if you want change, we've got to get the mindset to realize that outbreaks actually occur. And when you're in dealing with an infectious diseases, you should be expecting them. I couldn't help, as we were talking, thinking of some of you may have seen years ago that HBO series, A Band of Brothers, when the 101st Airborne was going into Baston as the army was retreating. And the guys in the army were saying, in the regular army were saying, why are you going in there? You're gonna get surrounded. And he looked at him, the major from the 101st and said, but we're paratroopers, we're supposed to be surrounded. So it's the same thing with infectious diseases. If you're an infectious disease person, you should expect that there are going to be outbreaks, and they shouldn't be surprises. So I'll leave you with that.
That's a very good image. Let's open for some comments and questions. We'll take three or four at a time. Sir, down here in front. Please identify yourself, and please be brief. There's a microphone. There?
Yes, thank you very much. My name is Dr. Benjamin O'Hare. I am the owner of First Consultants Medical Center in Lagos, Nigeria. We were the ones that jumped on the first and the last Ebola grenade. Now, thank you. I wanted to raise the issue that I think is very important going forward. Here is the issue of stigma. Now, I have I've come here because of what lies ahead. In a country of 160 million people, 18 people were infected, 12 were from my hospital. Now, 8 have survived, and they've been declared that their serum has the antibodies, but they're still suffering from stigma. Now, in a country and in a continent and in a zone where 70 to 90% of the people get their health care from the private people, how are we going to be able to introduce this? When right now, the practice is stop the fever. If you have a fever at the gate, you don't come into the hospital. So how are we going to be able to convince them? Because I heard a comment about participatory, because it means that you have to really go in there and talk to the people and get to know how to overcome their fears, which we now know as the stigma.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's take a few additional comments and questions right here. Sir?
My name is Wayne Pambianchi. I tip my hat to all of you. I think you've done a marvelous job from the beginnings of this outbreak to testing vaccines and drugs starting next month is really quite miraculous. One observation that strikes me, given the number of patients and the deaths, if I understood some of the earlier slides, only 2 drugs are being tested. It seems to me in this country alone, there must be many candidate drugs, and I wonder how the funnel got that narrow.
Thank you. There's a gentleman right behind you there.
Yeah, Ken Meyercord, World Docs. 8 years ago, the International Red Cross warned about the development of biological weapons that could target people based on genotype, for instance, race. Of the 16 white or yellow people who have contracted Ebola, all have survived except an elderly Spanish priest. So all the people who have died of Ebola are black. Does that mortality distinction, in addition to the off-the-chart number of infections and deaths that have occurred, suggest that the West Africa Ebola variant may be a weaponized version of the virus?
Okay, let's take one other. Is there any other? Right here, sir. We'll come to you in a moment in the second round. Yes.
Thank you. Again, I commend the effort here. I'm Greg Glenn. I'm the head of R&D at Novavax. We're a recombinant vaccine company. And I think the effort's commendable, and I don't want to put any potholes in the way. I think we should do what you're doing. I think the companies have mobilized in a tremendous way cooperatively. I would point out that these are vectors, and so we're very focused on just vector technology, and we know there are limitations. They haven't really worked in other settings. They have pre-existing immunity. They've developed very low immunity to the target antigen. And we have non-human primate data. So I think that that's the bet. And I believe a plan B should be at the forefront for a second kind of vaccine, because there is some chance that when we come to phase 2, we'll look at this and say, I don't know if that's something we would want to push forward into phase 3. So I'd appreciate comments on the long-term plan B sounds like it's being discussed. Is there a short-term backup plan?
Thank you. So we have a question around overcoming fears and stigma. Question around, is it only 2 drugs in development? Question around differentiation between black versus white versus US-based versus Africa population. Is this weaponizable? And then the appeal around plan B is, should there be a formal plan B put forward right now? Who'd like to jump in and pick off whatever piece of those you care to? Yes, Johan.
With regard to overcoming the stigma, I certainly don't have a panacea solution to that, but the point was raised earlier that people who are organizing such a study really need to have a lot of attention to specifically this aspect. It reminds me that we did trials with acellular pertussis in Senegal in the 90s, And we really had studied nurses who went into the compounds and actually really took their time to tell to the people about the vaccine. And it certainly was not the objective to have the vaccination done that day. So it really takes a lot of time of explaining and discussing such that you really get the trust of the people and get people on board. So I do think that socializing with the vaccine and what it stands for is an important aspect that all study teams that will be in place will need to take into account.
Monsen.
So we should engage, but we shouldn't underestimate how much of a challenge this is going to be.
Sure.
Because there is the stigma of having fever because it could be Ebola that has so many implications on the social tissue that, for instance, if any one of the vaccines induces fever after immunization, exactly how the community will react to that is something that we really need to be on the ground, and we need to absolutely work hand in hand with the local health authorities and community and investigators to make sure there isn't actually an unpredicted reaction that can be extremely detrimental to the introduction of the vaccine or to the conduct of a clinical trial. It is a significant concern. And I think the larger the population we immunize, the more concern there will be that there will be timely association between events that are not related to the vaccine mm-hmm. and the immunization. So very, very important, very important issue. I was going to address the second point. But
I just wanted to add that if you study the history of infectious diseases, whether you're talking about smallpox, plague, pandemic, flu, it's a history of stigma. Mm. I mean, it's an inevitable complication of the fear that outbreaks engage. So we would be very naive to think that isn't going to be a major challenge in the situation that we're facing here. Maybe not worse than it is anywhere else. I remember during SARS, people didn't eat in Chinese restaurants in Toronto. So, you know, we even highly educated people are vulnerable to that kind of irrational response to a threat. And we know that. We don't have an easy solution, but one really important aspect of it, at least in my experience, has been finding the local people who are trusted and help them understand the whole situation so that they can speak on behalf of their own communities and try to generate a little critical mass of trust, at least.
Did you get to complete your thought?
On that, yes, and you know, very much.
But the stigma is also seen in the United States. I don't know, some of you may have seen one of the television shows they had of all of the Ebola survivors, one of whom I took care of, Nina, so I know her very well. And they were asking, are you being embraced or is there a stigma? And they said it's like almost maybe 60-40. 60% of the people embrace them and 40% of the people stay away from them. And one of the, and I won't mention his name, but one of the Ebola survivors made the point that it's very easy for him to get a table in a restaurant now when he walks in, everybody. So it's not just in Nigeria.
Rohit.
Maybe a couple points on stigma. I mean, certainly, as some people may have seen in the news, some of the treatment of returning volunteers for Doctors Without Borders yes. back into the United States was a really big concern for us, and certainly that we need to be able to encourage people right. to really make these sacrifices to go in the field. It is important to note also that a lot of the staff that we have going, including some of my colleagues who normally do advocacy on the other issues we work on, are now in local communities in all the affected countries, really working on very local communications on the ground. And these are the resources that I think people don't see in the organizations that are in the field, but they are doing very hard work with people in the local community that are on the front line, really trying to communicate what the virus is about, how to respond to it, and to reduce the stigma. And I think to the extent that this is so focused on the medical aspects, it really sort of loses sight of the fact that that is where you can get the empowerment of local communities. Just to note also on the idea of simply that this is not going to be enough. As an organization, we are doing a lot around trials, but we have not stopped our very urgent calls for more teams and more infrastructure to go into the field and not simply for governments to offer funding in response to the outbreak. I'm glad that there will be a separate discussion on diagnostics because we do think alongside vaccines that really is going to be critical for turning around the response in the near future.
Johan?
Nothing special.
Yes. On this question around the pipeline of drugs and the testing.
It's just that we were only, testing out two at the outset, plus convalescent plasma, again, because of the concerns of supply. There are others that we are looking at that Dr. Fauci put up, and there are is a consideration also of some repurposed drugs to the extent that there's supply and that there's obviously very good safety data. So there are going to be others that are used, and I believe there are other trials that are using other drugs.
On this question around survivability and the numbers in the United States.
There's too many confounding factors, because if you look at the, quote, white people who were infected, a substantial proportion of them were evac'd to the United States where they got intensive care. And that doesn't mean that the physicians in West Africa aren't as good as the physicians here, but there you have one or two physicians taking care of 30 patients, whereas there we had, when we were taking care of Nina, we had like seven of us at one time taking care of her. So I think the survival of people when you're in intensive care and you're monitoring your electrolytes and you have IV central lines makes a big difference. I don't think that that's race. I think that just happens to be the distribution of people who are aerobacked.
And on plan B, I think, you know, it's a point I was making last week at the NIH, which is it's absolutely key that all the vaccine candidates are progressed. We don't know which is the better vaccine, and we don't know that we have enough vaccine of any one vaccine urgently enough, depending on how the situation unfolds and evolves. So we need to pursue all of them, and we need to help each other.
Thank you. That's a very, very nice way to draw things to a close here. We're at the end of our time. This has been an exceptionally rich and informed discussion. I thank all of you. And Natasha, thank you for joining us and weighing in on behalf of Gavi, Tony, Julie, Moncef, Johan, Rohit. Thank you so much for all of the energy.